Hi there, and welcome to Live from the Farm. We're here with Expanding Tourism on the Farm. We are in Oxford near Eastern Iowa. My name is Greg Padgett. I'm the Next Generation Director for Practical Farmers of Iowa. And I'm joined here with Anna Geyer, who we are standing in front of her cutting garden today. So today we're going to talk, Anna's going to share with us her experiences establishing and operating agritourism businesses here on the farm. And for those of you that haven't heard of agritourism, it's essentially when you create a business on a working farm that is created and generated for tourists or general public to come to your farm. So Anna and her husband Dave have been farming on this ground, on this 120 acres where Dave grew up. In addition to raising traditional row crops, hay, and grass-fed beef, Anna has created four agritourism enterprises, including Geyer's Oven, Crust and Crumb, Anna's Cutting Garden, and the Land Alliance Folk School and Retreat Center. So we'll cover all of those today. So as we're touring, please put your comments in the chat box, and I'll make sure to work those into my conversation with Anna today. But before I turn them over, I want to thank our, we have two sponsors for today's field day. We have Premier One Supplies and Iowa State Extension in helping make this field day possible today. So I will turn it over to you, Anna, if you want to share with us kind of how things got started in agritourism with your cutting garden here.
Sure. Well, the first thing I should say is that when I started, I had no intention of doing agritourism. I didn't even know what agritourism was. I was mostly interested in doing a CSA, but we had two very small children, and I didn't think I could handle it. So I decided to grow flowers instead. And underlying everything I did with the flowers was just this desire to create a beautiful space for people to gather. And so I made this space, opened it up for people to gather and to cut. You pick flowers, and for donations. So it was very casual, laid back, and I wasn't even thinking about business. And over time, that evolved into people asking me to do flowers for weddings. And so it ended up evolving into something I never intended, and turned into a business. And the wedding business is now mostly where my flowers end up.
So. Oh, fantastic. Yeah. So can you talk a little bit about how it was bringing customers onto your farm? Like, I think that kind of adds a different element to things.
It's great. I mean, everyone has their ways of being, and one of my ways of being is just very happy to be hospitable in that way. Mm-hmm. So having people in my space, on my land, that's really easy for me.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. Now, I know one way you do that is with the shelter behind me.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. When my husband Dave brought that in from another farm. They were building a new garage, and this was their old garage. And he put it on the back of a grain truck, and drove it over here and put it here for me, and then the garden grew up around it. So it has served many purposes over time.
Oh, fantastic.
And right now, the latest thing that I've been doing with it is using it for glamping.
Okay. How wonderful.
Yeah.
And you have kind of an aspect of kind of a retreat spaces as well.
Right. I think everything that I do has really been based on creating space for people to inhabit and space for people to sort of step back and breathe and sort of imagine that could actually be life, you know? And so, can't remember your question.
About the retreat spaces.
Yeah. So yes, retreat is kind of built into everything I do, and certainly the flowers, creating space for people to just inhabit that space.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, and the couple times I've been out here, there's always people, and it's always neat to meet new people and just to hear their stories.
It's always fantastic. I love it. It certainly opens up the world to me, too, because I get to hear all about everywhere from the guests that come.
How wonderful.
Yeah.
Has there been any challenges with bringing guests onto the farm?
Well, actually, I don't, like, right off the top of my head, there's not a lot of challenges to having people here. I mean, most of my challenges have been from running the businesses. county regulations, just all the details of running a business, those are the challenges that really stretch me. But really, the people have not been very hard for me to have around.
Wonderful to hear.
Yeah, they've been wonderful.
Well, I'm sure you attract the people that, with the spaces you've created.
I think that's true. I think the ambience that you create attracts a certain people that like that and respond to it.
For sure.
Yeah.
How wonderful. And so how long after the cutting garden started and people, you started with that piece, did you add the pizzas?
That's a good question. Maybe 5-6 years. Yeah, and that was sort of accidental. I was working for a woman just 4 miles south of here. Her name was Simone DeLady, I think is her last name. And she ran Simone's Plain and Simple, so some people may remember that. So I was running her oven for her and operating her kitchen for her. And she said, Anna, you should have your own oven. And I was like, no, no. And I came home and mentioned it to my husband. He's like, yes. So we built this stone oven, which you'll see in a minute, first.
How wonderful.
And then, and I just imagined that it would be an extension of the flowers. It'd be like another place where people could gather and inhabit that space and see beauty and relax.
Yeah.
Sort of that retreat concept. And it certainly took off in a way I was not expecting.
Oh, wonderful. Well, let's go check out the oven.
Yeah.
Because you have the first oven here you guys built, right?
We built them all, actually.
Oh, but you built all of them. Okay.
The stone oven was our first oven.
Okay. I'm sure there was a learning curve with trying to figure out how to build an oven.
Right. Yeah, where do you want to be? Here?
Yeah. Does that work?
Mm-hmm.
So tell us a little bit about the oven and what it was like to build this.
Yeah, actually, I designed a workshop, invited someone from California who runs Oven Crafters, an oven design and building company. And Oven Crafters sent someone out to help to run the workshop and teach us how to build these ovens. And 10 people from around the state who wanted to learn how to build their own ovens were here. So in one weekend, we built the oven core, the underlayers in the oven core. And then it took Dave and I 2.5 years to do the stonework.
Oh my gosh.
One of the men that came to the workshop was a stonemason, and we asked if he would teach us how, and he took us to Decora to his house, which was stone. He was building his own house, and taught us how to do the stonework.
Oh, amazing. So, now, where did you find all the stone?
We rescued it from an old foundation of a house just about 3 miles south of here.
Oh, wonderful.
They just gave it to us.
What a great repurpose.
Yeah, yeah.
So tell us a little bit how pizza night works when you're going.
That's a good question. It's a well-oiled machine. I mean, when we first started, we had 8 people here, and we all just stood around the oven, one oven, stood around the oven and ate pizza off the table with napkins. You know, that's what it looked like. And then our last event pre-COVID, that summer, our biggest night was 800. So it grew, and every winter I was adjusting systems to grow with it. So every year in the off season, I was redesigning or rearranging the kitchen, adding the equipment that I needed for a larger crowd, and just building new ovens. I mean, now we have 4 ovens, 3 of them are out here. So it was just always keeping up with that growth and always trying to design systems that would take away the thinking and just like you could just, so my crew could just work without having to make decisions while we're working. So it's just a lot of conscious planning for growth and also a lot of creating systems that really worked well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden now you had employees. Like, how is that to manage from,
so,
that's a big jump.
So my nature, as I mentioned earlier, is really wired for hospitality and wired to have people in my space, and I was really good at that. What was really hard for me and stretching for me is managing a crew of up now, ended at 25 people and 2 managers. So that kind of leadership was something I'd never done before. Uh-huh. I was the youngest child in a family, youngest and quietest, and so kind of stepping into that kind of leadership was a real stretch for me. And thankfully that grew over time. But I think as an agritourism, in agritourism in general, I think that's certainly things that farmers have to face, yeah. is how do we add to our team? How do we train our team? How do we manage our team? How do we maintain the health of our team? It's, yeah. There's a lot of questions there.
Uh-huh, yeah. For sure. But, and like you were saying earlier, different challenges
weren't
quite ready for.
Yeah, and I'm so proud of my crew. My crew is amazing, and that also was the part that stretched me the most.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about, because you took 2021 off of doing pizzas, so you pushed through COVID and then took a year off.
Right. I mean, I had been doing pizza since 2005, and I was ready for a break. Uh-huh. And so when COVID happened, I thought this would be the year to take a break. But the manager that I had hired really wanted to create a online ordering system and a pickup and takeout system, and my pizza guests were asking for the same thing. Mm-hmm. So I did it, and I think that I probably shouldn't have. It was beautiful. People loved it. It was such a different pace. It was so relaxed. It was entirely different experience, yeah. and it was lovely. But I really did need a break, and I didn't get one.
Yeah.
Because transitioning from the systems that we have to those new systems took a lot of work, and I was training a new crew that was very small. So this year I said, okay, this year might break.
Well, and it sounds like now you've got a lot of different experiences with the systems you had in place and mm-hmm. the volume that we were doing. But now kind of a different view with how you ran through 2020 with kind of a different relaxed view. And how can you, I'm sure there's a lot going in your head right now on how to merge those two together.
Right. Yeah. Pre-pandemic, we also did small private events. So we did large events, the hundreds of people, but we also did private events. So we were kind of used to doing, but the online ordering and organizing all that was a whole nother.
Yeah, I can imagine that's a whole nother piece.
Yeah.
So as it expanded, you expanded ovens as well, because then you built this oven on the side here, it sounds like.
Right. We built the third oven in the winter, but in this one we built in the middle of the summer, and there was no time to do it as a normal masonry oven and cure it and get it.
Yeah.
So this one was just dry stacked. I watched a YouTube video. My husband got me a hog waterer to set the oven on. So underneath there's a hog water. I dry stacked it. He built me a frame, and we tested it at one pizza night, and it worked. So between that and the next event, I built the housing.
Oh, fantastic.
Fast. It's just, again, speaking of agritourism, that adaptability and sort of being able to sort of roll with what comes, it seems like a huge piece of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and especially having to pivot in the middle of the season like you did with adding that second oven, like that takes a lot of time in a busy time to try to to make those big decisions.
Right.
Now, where do people enjoy their pizza when they're out here?
Well, the yard is full, and this pasture, which is tall now, was all mown, and so that would have been full of people as well.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
And you have so many great little spaces with the cutting garden and little great shade, and you can really, it seems like each family could find their own spot that really suits them.
Yeah, I mean, the reason it's the way it is now is during the pandemic. Last year when we were doing this during the pandemic, we mowed little keyhole patches in this tall grass and put a picnic table in each one, so they had socially distant outdoor places to do their tailgate.
Their own little pod to stay socially distanced.
Yeah.
How wonderful. So as you expanded, I'm sure you've hit more challenges with licensing and regulation, and what was, how did you tackle those hurdles?
And actually, there's a part of me that wonders, had I not had that element to deal with, how this experience would have been different. Because, you know, I say growing a crew was a big stretch for me, definitely navigating, and we're in Johnson County, so navigating Johnson County regulations was exhausting.
Mm-hmm.
So had it just been running my business, how would have that been different? So I certainly think that for people who are out there thinking about doing agritourism, my advice around county systems is just take a deep breath and just like give yourself a lot of grace to be in it for the long haul. And hopefully you're in a county that will not be this way. But if you can navigate the county health department, the zoning department, the building department, you know, find out what is needed, find out what they require. And then if they shut you down or say you can't do this, go read the codes. Get very familiar with the codes and with all of the legal stuff that they have written that's allowed and what's not allowed. Because often if they say this isn't allowed, you can find a way to do it through another part of the ordinance.
Okay.
So it is a hassle, it is no fun, but if you're patient and steadfast and diplomatic, you can make things happen even when it feels like there's a dead end.
Yeah.
And we ran into that often.
Sounds like asking a lot of questions and just continuing to learn.
And be very persistent.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was, and I'm not the only one who's gone through this. I mean, it is hard work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and outside of the county, what about insurance?
Insurance is a huge obstacle as well. I mean, when you have hundreds of people showing up, the insurance is significant. And we were required to get commercial insurance. So yeah, if you need insurance, looking into that's a big deal. And again, that just is like a deep breath. Give yourself grace to sort of find your way through it. Ask people who've done it. Ask ask other agritourism people what insurance company they use. Just,
yeah.
It's another piece that's really hard, and it's like expensive, so these are all things.
So be ready.
Yeah.
Yeah. Any important questions that everyone should ask when they're looking for an agent or trying to find that insurance?
Yeah, I would say ask people who've done it, because, I mean, I've done it all these years with one company, and I just found out from a friend that she has a company that has been serving her really well and that I would like to look into.
Yeah.
So just asking people what their experiences have been and what has worked for them, your peer support is going to serve you really well, I think.
Okay. Yeah. We can learn so much from each other.
Yeah.
It's so important.
Because the companies will all tell you they're awesome, and they all serve you at some level.
Yeah.
But your peers are going to be able to tell you their experience.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
For sure. So now when you were expanding, and you said that at one point you were up the highest of 800 for pizza night, it sounds like you also had some county regulations that changed that when you hit that level that you had that required some larger infrastructure as well.
Yeah, actually when we hit 400 people, the county required us to put in public restrooms, 2 for men, 2 for women, 2 stalls for each. Another 225 feet of septic and another tank, just enormous amount of infrastructure.
Uh-huh.
And at that point, the entire basement of our house is pizza kitchen. And my crew had filled that up and was pretty tight in there. So I needed more kitchen space. I was required to do these restrooms. I was thinking about the folk school, and I had people asking for events and the cutting garden, you know, all of these things. So I designed a building that would be versatile and adaptable and usable just in many ways.
Yeah.
So that if I had to put that expense out, hopefully it would have revenue streams that would serve it from a number of different directions. And that's one way to leverage your resources and your time to make it more sustainable as a business.
Yeah, that's a really clever idea to kind of diversify and manage those well.
Yeah.
Well, let's go check out the folk school.
We'll okay.
Check out the building up here.
Okay.
So how did you go about building this?
Well, we're do-it-yourselfers.
Uh-huh.
And so before this, everything we did, Dave brought this building in. We redid our own house. Like, everything we do, he built his shop, everything. So to be required to put in a building and to do it to commercial standards was just so daunting.
I can imagine.
And it required us to hire, you know, I step into things sort of clueless sometimes. So I ended up serving as a general contractor, although I didn't know that that's what I was doing. I just started calling people and saying, can you do the cement work? Can you do the electrical? So I just learned as I went, and we built this thing to commercial standards. And then the minute I got past code, I started doing everything else myself. So the painting, I did the trim, all the trim work inside, which is very simple, but you know, it took time. we built the stalls to the bathroom ourselves out of the remainder of the barn boards that were left over. We built those bathroom stalls.
That's clever.
I did the floors upstairs, the wood hardwood floors. I put those in myself. So it was this combination of commercial and then, you know, saving money in any way we could, which is helpful.
Wonderful.
With a project like this.
Yeah. And what a great structure to have in light of the necessity behind it.
Yeah. And this is what I would say to people. I had the choice of either building these bathrooms or completely dismantling the business. Mm-hmm. And I decided to dismantle the business. I just decided, okay, I'm not going to do it. It's too much. But there were so many little things that kept pushing me ahead and pushing me forward and encouraging me to kind of step into that. Yeah. It was terrifying. But I have been so grateful for it. It has served us in so many ways. And during the pandemic, when so much else was shut down, we were able to let guests use that during the pandemic. So
yeah.
It's just been, it's been good.
How wonderful.
Yeah.
And it gave you the opportunity to open the folk school. Can you talk a little bit about what that is? Because some people may not even know what a folk school is.
Right. Folk schools grew out of Denmark, actually, after one of the world wars when their economy was devastated. And they needed to have some kind of economic development to retrain, give people new skills to, regenerate the economy. So the folk schools were called schools for life. They were both economic, but they were also, how do we live well? Mm-hmm. How do we do community well? How do we heal from this?
Yeah.
And so that was where they began, and then they migrated to the U.S. And in the U.S., they've taken the form of sort of cultural preservation. So historical skills, the crafts of like blacksmithing and canning and quilting and basket making, all these sorts of things. But then also the historical art and music and folk traditions of the historic people of whatever area you're in. And then it's also they take on elements of social concerns. So during the civil rights movement, the Highlander Folk School focused entirely on civil rights. So you get the idea that folk schools can be very diverse, and some focus on just one thing and some focus on a number of things.
Mm-hmm. So what's your focus here?
Well, it's been evolving. I mean, I have background in art and music, and obviously I have background in craft skills.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm learning about myself through all of this is that I love to create something beautiful, get it sustaining, get it running and sustaining itself, and then I could happily walk away. Uh-huh. It's that creative process that is really where I get life. So the element of economic development or entrepreneurship is really the element that I feel is maybe my strongest gift to offer. So in our particular folk school right now, we offer a number of things, classes at all levels, but I'm adding that element of entrepreneurship as one of the main focuses.
How neat.
Yeah.
And kind of going back to the roots of where the idea came from as well.
And I don't know that, I've never seen another folk school do this.
Yeah.
But it's very historically accurate. So it's interesting to me that has emerged.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, wonderful. Well, and even through that, I'm sure you've had to build new connections. Because all of a sudden you can't do all the teaching in the folk school.
Right, right. It's another situation where really it needs to be a team, and there needs to be a lot of support.
Yeah.
And that, again, that's the part that stretches me most. And next week, or is it the next week, I have a team that's gathering to have, these are people who really want to support the curriculum and programming and are sort of gathering to sort of plan for the future.
Okay.
So I am, that is emerging, and
yeah.
I'm really grateful for that.
That sounds like kind of that passion that you're creating and helping others kind of take the next step,
yeah.
Which is really exciting.
Yeah. I really love empowering other people to do what they're excited about. That's, again, I think part of the entrepreneurship piece is just really supporting other people in their dreams and their vision for what they're trying to create.
Yeah.
It's just such a joy.
How fun.
Such a joy.
Sounds like you're really building your own community within a community.
I think that is often the case for businesses. Enterprises do often create a community within the people who are working there, but also within the community that support. It's like often the outcome of a business that hasn't, has that desire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful. So how do you get word out about the things you're doing here? Because it sounds like things are working and people are finding out about it, but how?
Well, this is funny because my entrepreneurship students last year wanted me to teach a course on just marketing. Uh-huh. And I'm like, I probably am not your person. because marketing has never been something I've given energy to. It just always seems to emerge in a way that comes naturally. I don't know how it happens.
Yeah.
But one of the things as I was researching, I told them, I'll research it and see if I can come up with something for you. And one of the things that was said to me was, you have to take what's unconscious, that you do well but is unconscious, mm-hmm. and make it conscious. So I'm sitting with myself, I'm like, what do I do that brings people here? And I ask my customers that because they sometimes can tell me better than I know myself. Mm-hmm. So their feedback often gives me a clue into what I'm doing that actually is marketing.
Okay.
Because inherently at its very core, marketing is just about sharing what you do.
Yeah.
Like letting people know. And so that's been an interesting journey for me, is trying to figure out what is it that I'm doing that.
Yeah.
And it's fun. I'm learning some things.
How wonderful.
And I'll have something to teach them.
Yeah, I like that advice. And they kind of, because when I work with our beginning farmers, I'm always telling them, find what's unique and what really drives you and that passion, because that's what you can sell. That's what you can talk about.
Genuinely.
Yes.
Yeah, genuinely. If it's really something that gives you joy, you can genuinely sell it with so much integrity.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's great advice.
Wonderful. Well, good. I think that is kind of wrapped up the things I wanted to hit today. Is there anything else you want to share with the audience, or tips or advice on others that are thinking about adding agritourism as a part of their farming operation?
Yeah, I do have some advice on that. I would say, first of all, it's courageous work. It's hard, so just go into it with sort of steadiness and sort of be persistent and be willing to sort of sustain yourself through a lot of hard learning. But also make sure you keep attached to your joy. Like, what is it that you do love about it? And pay attention to where your energy comes from and give your energy there. Mm-hmm. It's so easy to get pulled into places that take your energy, but like, give that work to someone else and stay where your energy is. That'd be one advice. And the other piece is really set boundaries on your time. I mean, farmers already are working really hard. Mm-hmm. So figure out how to set boundaries on your time so it doesn't kill you or take you away from your family Anyway,
that's
my 2 cents.
Sound advice. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Well, good. Well, thank you again, Anna, for hosting us out here. This is a lovely day and a beautiful place for us to share with the world. So I'm glad we were able to share this out there. But I want to appreciate everybody for tuning in today. We'll throw a link in the chat in the description to click on and give us your feedback today. But I want to remind you that we're Practical Farmers of Iowa. We're a nonprofit based in Iowa that is working to equip farmers with farmer-led research and knowledge sharing. So we want farmers to learn through the community that they learn best through. So I invite you to join us next week, where Jill Bebout is going to show us her packing station. So we're going to be live in her packing shed as she's packing veggie boxes for her customers. So until next time, so long.